I'm Ron Ketelsen, and I'm president of the Sharon Historical Society. We'd like to welcome you to our program on the Adler Hotel, From Heyday to Present Day. We'd like to thank all of the participants tonight who share their stories and their interviews to make this a very successful presentation. So we'd like to get started, and let me share my screen with you. Before we get started, I'm going to tell you just a little bit of the background of Sharon Springs. Many of you are not local, so I want to just tell you a little bit about the background. The town of Sharon, it was called New Dorlach when it was originally founded. It was a German settlement. It was located on the southwest corner of Schoharie County in New York. The town was named Sharon after Sharon, Connecticut, where many of the settlers originated from. The village of Sharon was incorporated in 1871, and it brought together the former hamlet of Rockville, which was located on a rock ledge along the present Route 20. And the summer resort surrounded the mineral springs lying in the ravine below. Throughout Sharon's history, the town had weathered many changes and seen many economic recessions and recoveries. David Eldridge was one of the first settlers, and he was the first to build a rooming house near the spring in the lower village of Sharon Springs. And it was because of the springs and their healing properties that Sharon Springs had grown into a popular summer resort destination in the 19th century. It attracted thousands of visitors annually. Native Americans were the first to use the springs of Sharon, and they used it for medicinal and healing purposes. The springs would gush from the small brook above down through a steep wooden slope. And within the short distance of each other are five different types of springs. There's a sulfur spring, two different magnesia springs, a chalybeate or an iron spring, and a bluestone spring containing elements considered valuable for the treatment of eye disease, which made Sharon a popular spa destination for over 10,000 visitors every summer. By the mid-1800s, the springs had become world famous. Sharon Springs had reached its peak as a health spa in the 1920s, when it boasted some 60 hotels and boarding houses, which accommodated over 10,000 guests. Sharon Springs has hosted many of the rich and famous, including U.S. President Martin Van Buren, the Vanderbilts, Ulysses S. Grant, Theodore Roosevelt, Franklin D. Roosevelt, the Van Rensselaer family, Charles Dickens, James Fenimore Cooper, Oscar Wilde, the Macy's of New York, movie producer Steven Spielberg, and Martha Stewart. I mentioned Steven Spielberg. He came here when he was producing Schindler's List, and we had many, many Holocaust survivors who stayed at the Adler, and he came to the Adler to interview them for the background of his movie. Resources that led to Sharon's success also contributed to its demise: the turnover of spa owners, the aging of its original visitors, financial troubles, the deterioration of many of the hotels, a series of disastrous fires. It meant that new proprietors were not as tied to the town. Other factors that led to its inevitable decline were that of a national scale. The hops market failed when Prohibition was introduced in 1920, and a bank moratorium brought financial ruin to many residents during the early years of the Depression. Passenger service of the Sharon Springs D&H Railroad ended in 1932, severing the artery which carried the majority of its guests to the resorts. Soon after Prohibition ended in 1934 and the Depression had ruined the finances of the clientele, its owners and local residents once again, a new form of transportation, the automobile, transformed Sharon's character. The automobile may have been the greatest factor that brought the glory days of Sharon Springs to an end. New types of accommodations, motels and motor courts, such as the Commodore, Davis Cabins, and Egan's Point appeared along the new route. These establishments catered to the automobile culture, emphasizing independent travel and do-it-yourself convenience, a far cry from the all-inclusive services of hotels like the Adler. The tourist and resort industry in Sharon received a severe blow when in 1954, the New York State Thruway opened its new section from Utica to Newburgh, and the traffic on Route 20 decreased drastically. Well, the village flourished for many years, but things began to slow down by the 1980s. A lot of the buildings in Sharon Springs, built mainly in the early 20th century, fell into a state of disrepair and were later left abandoned or demolished. They included the Adler Hotel, which finally closed its doors in 2004. This is a picture of the Empire Hotel. This hotel collapsed recently and had to be torn down. The spa resort potential also attracted another entrepreneurial individual to Sharon Springs. A young man by the name of Lewis Adler came to the spa town in the early 1920s because he'd heard about the popularity of the spa treatments. Adler, who was a former tailor from South Orange, New Jersey, decided to bring his wife Rose and his family to Sharon Springs and start a new business as a hotel proprietor. Well, his wife Rose is on the far right, and she's got her hand on Lewis's shoulder. Their son Artie is in front of them. Most of these girls are Louis's sisters, and you can see Louis's parents are sitting in the center of the picture. Here's a picture of Louis and his wife Rose shortly before coming to Sharon Springs. Louis and Rose Adler had three children, Arthur, or Artie as they called him, Teresa, whose nickname was Tessie, and Jeanette, who's on the far right. Here's a photo that was taken of Louis Adler at the Adler Hotel. Here's a portrait of Louis Adler, the original owner of the Adler Hotel. This is a picture of Louis and his wife Rose. They were on a cruise in St. Thomas in the Virgin Islands, and this picture was taken just about 5 minutes before he died of a stroke. In addition to owning the Adler Hotel, Louis and Rose also own five other hotels: the Leamington Hotel in Miami Beach, Florida, the Bayshore Hotel in Tampa, Florida, the Allison Hotel in Miami Beach, Florida, and notice the A in Allison is the same as the A in the Adler Hotel. They also owned the Ponce de Leon Hotel in Miami City and the Victor Hotel in South Beach. The Adlers would spend their winters at that hotel, and their summers they would come up here to Sharon Springs and stay at the Adler Hotel. When Louis Adler first came to Sharon Springs, he bought the Eldridge House that was built in 1874 on the corner of South Street and Willow Street. The Eldridge House was completely remodeled in 1914, and it advertised a music room and a parlor for its guests. In the early 1920s, Louis Adler bought it from the Eldridges and renamed it the Adler House. Louis and Rose Adler ran the establishment until he constructed the new Adler Hotel in 1928. Well, the former Adler House was later renamed the new Sharon House, and it burned on May 7th in 1957. And in the photo at the bottom, the Adler House would have been on the left side of the photo. In 1927, Louis Adler began to build a new hotel just north of Pavilion Drive in Sharon Springs. It was called the Adler Hotel, and it was built by Adler for a price of $250,000 in 1927. The hotel had 150 rooms and was the last of the large hotels to be built in Sharon Springs. It had its own baths and massage, a ballroom, a dining room with a stage for entertainment, and a tea room. And the hotel was initially marketed to Jewish clientele who liked to visit Sharon Springs in the summer. It had two kitchens, which were kosher. It was built in the shaped with shaped gables and an arcade porch and stucco walls that were built in the Spanish colonial revival style, which was really popular at the time. Well, the Adler sold the hotel in 1950 to Bernard and Hilda Weider, and They made their names for themselves also for operating a number of hotels in Florida. And they bought the hotel from Louis Adler for what he paid for it, $250,000. However, they sold it in 1971 for $75,000 to the Yarkoni family. And the hotel finally closed in 2004. Well, let's take a look at some home movies that were taken by the Adler family. These were taken in the late 20s and 30s. And unfortunately, a lot of the film was damaged, but we were able to get some of, and these came from the Adler family. I'd like to thank Eric Adler for providing this video.
The following scenes that you're going to see are a compilation of some old film that we dug out. And unfortunately, a lot of it was lost, but the picture that you're looking at right now is a showing my mother, Rose Adler, walking between the Adler Hotel and the old Pavilion Hotel. There she is directing some of the guests as to what to do. This is at the Hotel Adler in Sharon Springs, New York. There's the Adler Hotel again. We used to open a hotel in the end of May and close it right after Labor Day. It was too cold to operate in the wintertime. We weren't really fitted out with steam heat. This is a long-distance shot of the Adler Hotel up in Sharon Springs, situated right outside the Mohawk Valley, about 12 miles from the scene of the famous Mohawk massacre between the Mohawk Indians and the settlers at that time. This is another view of the Adler Hotel, and there it was. The hotel was built, opened in 1928, and built by my father, Louis, and myself. Here's a picture of Essie on horseback with the white trousers, and Irving Kleiman and a couple of the other employees of the hotel. This is view of the dining room staff. That's Irving Kleiman, the maitre d' at that time. These are the chefs that we had, the prima donnas, as we used to call them, with Irving Kleiman and my father, Louis. The Adler Hotel was a hotel of about 150 rooms. And one of the features that we had there was that we had the sulfur bath treatments inside the building, and was the only hotel in the area that had that facility for the guests. Tour of the golf course with the pro making a couple of swings and myself making a couple of bad swings. This is a picture of Willie Becker and my sister Jeanette. The fellow who just put the stuff on top of the car was Julie Myers of the Myers Parking. This is a picture of the first package tour that we had in conjunction with the Albany Nightline and the Adler Hotel and the Greyhound bus. This is a decoration of the guests of the hotel. Fooling around, having a good time. There's Papa Louie. These guests used to come to the hotel to take the sulfur baths, and they'd stay there at least 3 weeks for the entire course. And used to come back year in and year out, being a little fearful of that if they didn't come out, why they'd be sick maybe the following winter. I think those pictures were taken about 1934, 35. There's Pop again. This shows you what a little sulfur water will do. There's Mama and Pop.
Now we're going to take a look at some pictures from the Adler Hotel. These were taken after the hotel had closed and it was now up for sale. There's the outside of the hotel, and as you can see, it's looking pretty good. Freshly painted, it looks like. There's a picture of the front desk, and you can see what the lobby looked like. There's a staircase going up to the upper floors. There's another picture of the front desk. You can see the mail slots. Those are still there today. And you can see the switchboard on the left. We'll see some other pictures of that. This is kind of interesting. I want you to kind of take note, a mental note of this picture. This was the card room. And we'll see a little later a picture of what it looks like currently. This is the ballroom, and you can see the main stage up on the top there, grand piano. That's where the orchestra played, and they had all kinds of entertainment. They had plays. They brought in bands. They had staff night where the staff entertained. It was quite a large room, and they had all matching chairs, very nice, and had nice chandeliers. Unfortunately, those were all stolen. This is the dining room. And there's a picture of some of the table service from the Adler. You can see they have their own engraved silverware. This was the stage in the dining room. It had a grand piano. That piano is now at Clinkhart Hall. It's the art center that they're working on renovating now in Sharon Springs. Here's a picture in the dining room. This was being set for a wedding. This is a picture of the lobby, and you can see in the early days, they had a floral print on the couches and chairs. And in later years, this is a little bit more modern, and this was probably in about 2000. There's another picture of the switchboard. That switchboard is now in the Historical Society Museum. I took that switchboard out early this year. There was so much vandalism going on at the hotel that I was worried if we didn't take the switchboard, it would be completely destroyed. Actually, they took the dialer off, but everything else was pretty much there. Weighed a ton, and trying to get that out, I had to take all the battery packs out, and trying to get it down the stairs was quite a job. Here's a picture of an ad that was in the Wall Street Journal advertising the hotel. And there's some canceled checks. These were when Louis Adler were still signing the checks. These were about 1940. Now we'll listen to some interviews Some of these people had stories from the time when the Adler was open, and some of these people worked at the hotel.
I'm Maureen Lotus, and I'm owner of Cobbler & Company in the village of Sharon Springs. When I first opened the shop in 1997, the Adler was open and active. Many of the Adler customers would come and shop here, as we were the only shop in town, so they really had no choice. And it was a great place to walk to on Shabbos when they couldn't drive. My daughter worked for the Adler for 2 years, probably like 1996, 1997. So she has her own share of stories that she shared with me, and I have my own experiences from here in the shop, and they all intertwine beautifully. As far as my daughter working there, she was a waitress, started first year as a bus girl, and then she was a waitress. It was very Catskill-esque, where the same people would come up for a week or more, depending upon the reparations and what they were permitted. But they would sit at the same table for the whole time and have the same waitress, so she got to know some of the people pretty well. Interesting, as an Irish Catholic kid, we didn't know much about the Jewish traditions, but she learned, and she learned well. She really fell in love with all of her customers. She was intrigued by their history and the experiences that they had gone through, and they delighted in telling her much of the horrific events that were part of their lives. She witnessed people on the front porch that met each other first time since the camps. There was a lady telling a story about being in the kitchen, and she was able to put aside some food, and as we all know, that was difficult for the prisoners to get fed properly. So she had told her friends in the kitchen, "I've got some food, come after and we'll share it." And there was a young girl that really admonished her and said, "You know, what are you crazy? You're gonna, you know, we're gonna get killed over this. There's people waiting to take our place." And as she was telling the story, the one lady got up and she said, "What year was that? What camp was that?" And they exchanged information, and lo and behold, she turned to the woman. She said, "I was the girl that admonished you." And they embraced and hugged, and just a really tearful moment. But there was a perfect example of the citizenship that occurred in the Adler.
We'll listen to a few more interviews of the people that work there.
My name is Patricia Neal Dosti, and I worked at the Adler, I believe, from the summers of 57 to 60. I was a switchboard operator, and I worked 63 hours for $50 a week, and I thought that was great. And I had a big crush on the bell captain, Bruce Herman, and I ended up going to Florida with the Weeder family, who owned the Adler, and them, and it was fun. Oh, we used to have, every Monday night was staff night, so we joined the guests in the ballroom, and we had dance contests, and I remember one of the lifeguards and I won the dance contest.
Well, starting in 1958 through 1961, they had their own spa in the basement of the hotel, and then since I was the elevator operator, I got to bring down a number of the people who were staying there down into the spa. The ballroom was quite large, from what I remember, and they had service there every Friday evening, and in the ballroom. As far as the dining room was concerned, I don't remember much about it, since I worked at the bellhop desk, which was the main lobby, and down and help people up their luggage, put their luggage in. The people that stayed there, for no recall, I cannot recall a bad instance at all. The people friendly, and they treated you very, very nice, and my treatment, and By the way, I found a 1959 W-2 form. And in 1959, I made $135. As far as sleeping arrangements were concerned, I commuted from my home. That's the guys had a bed upstairs in the attic, which is not too good thing to say the least. And then the female workers stayed in the basement. It was a lot cooler. So I drove back and forth between my home and the Adler Hotel. My shift started at My shift started at 7 a.m. And since I ran the elevator, I had a bucket that I took to the main spa for first thing in the morning, filled it up with sulfur, the water from the spa, and took it to the kitchen where I warmed it up. And while I was warming up on the stove, got my glasses, I'm on a tray, and a little plate where I put my seed money on there so they get to tip me, and then went out to the elevator after the or got warmed up, and then waited for the buzzers to go off in the elevator that says what floor to go to pick up someone who was going down to the spa. And they would drink a glass of that warm sulfur water that were coming down the elevator and go into the spa.
There was another woman that she told the story of. She very much like the Von Trapp family, was from Vienna, and she escaped over the mountains. Her family had been wealthy, and she and her, I think, two siblings and mother and father were going to escape. Well, the father was very close to his father-in-law and went to say goodbye. His wife followed him, and the children saw them being shot in the back as they went to see, to say goodbye to the wife's father. It was obviously a horrific experience for them, but they then made a shelter behind their old house, and the servants were still, the Germans had taken over their house, and the servants were still very loyal to her and the children, and would sneak food, but they literally dug a hole, lined it with pine boughs, and that's where they would sleep. They would cover themselves with pine boughs at night, and that's how they survived the war. So there was interesting part, there were 9 languages spoken at one time in that dining room, and it was just kind of a compilation of especially Middle European, Slovakians, Polish. Here at the shop I have a signature wall, and you can see there's 30 countries represented, many of whom had come from the Adler that were part of the camp.
I believe I was working there in 1970 and 1971 because the Yarkonis had just purchased it. They really worked hard at making sure that everything was kosher, had a rabbi on the premises. I'm not sure that that was necessarily true when the readers were there. It probably was a little more relaxed. I was talking with Miriam this morning, and she said he had come up to visit when the Weeders owned it, and just really kind of on a quick whim was asked whether he wanted to buy it, and said, yeah, I'll buy it. But that's the kind of person that Mr. Yarkoni was. He was energetic, he was optimistic, and he was open to almost any suggestion.
Here I had my own experiences with the shoppers that would come in. So on Saturday, Shabbos, no one was allowed to drive. No one was allowed to shop or touch money. But the couples would walk up from the Adler, and they would come in, and they would look around, and the women would all wait till their husbands kind of walked outside because they got bored. So they would walk outside and chat, and the women would say, Maureen, I'm not shopping, I'm just looking. But I want you to put that little blue purse, maybe put it to the side, because tomorrow when I am shopping, that way I can find it. And so by the time the day was over, I had this line of shopping bags behind the desk filled with just looking, not shopping people. The next day, the ladies would come in and they'd make their purchases. And they don't tell Mrs. Goldberg, because I want to show her myself, because I wanted a surprise. And they would also come and talk about Maureen and, oh, she's such a pretty girl, don't let the boys touch her. But they did. They developed a great sense. She developed some good pen pals through the years when her time was over. The tea room at night, every once in a while, Maureen used to have to stay late to serve tea in the tea room, which was, I mean, the lobby was, you'd walk in the lobby, and it was a wide expanse, had a great staircase with an Art Deco lamp at the end of the newel post. You'd look over at the desk, and there was Mrs. Iarconi, or Miriam's mother, hello, with the switchboard like the Lily Tomlinson one. Hello, Adler Hotel, how can I help you? And she would go on, and it had the little pigeonholes for the people's mail. And then the elevator was the kind where you, the old-fashioned kind where the grate would come across, and you would have the handle, and sometimes the kids didn't always bring it level, but anyway, they tried. And that went down from the basement where the baths were all the way up to the different rooms. And the tea room was an eccentric room. It was, there were multiple kinds of wallpaper in there. They didn't all match necessarily, but when there was, I remember, really remember the pink paisley wallpaper on one wall, and then there was something else on another wall. It was probably left over from when they did their house or whatever they did. But the ladies would come down for tea. Also, when Maureen first worked there, she babysat for the rabbi's children. That's how she learned the kosher service and learned some of the teachings of the Orthodox religion and why certain things happened, what some of their traditions were and why they were there, why they didn't eat meat and milk in the same meal. So he described what happened and what brought that about and why they didn't eat pork and, you know, so forth and so on down the line. But in the dining room, there was a little alcove where there was a piano in there. And then, of course, the ballroom had the baby grand. Freddie's office was behind the stage. And the kitchen was huge. Well, it was two kitchens and with the family table in the middle. But it was an interesting place, definitely.
Hi, my name is Mike Hotchkiss. My mother is an Adler by birth. And her father, Louis Adler, built this once amazingly wonderful hotel in 1928. It was an amazing place to grow up, and it is really devastating to see what has happened to it. And this part of the porch was a wonderful place, and it was occupied with rocking chairs and guests and people walking across that bridge at the end, which would lead up to the cottages and the pavilion on the other side. And as kids, we used to stand under the bridge and wait for the ladies to walk by so we could look up their dresses. There was the elevator. And as a kid, I used to operate the elevator. And it was a really magnificent room. And of course, there was the front desk, where people came and checked in. And I must say, in all honesty, that it appeared to be much larger than it is now. And that was a stairway if you chose to walk upstairs. And the ballroom and the bar were to the right. And the dining room and then the kitchen were to the left. This is the ballroom, where it was the center of entertainment for the hotel. Occasionally they hired outside performers to come in. They had dancing, dance instruction, singing, bands, the works. And my father, Jerry, who was one of the main employees at the hotel, worked behind the desk and was one of the major entertainers. And I do remember this, that as a little kid, when he used to come out to sing, I ran away. I remember that. I'm going to take you back now to where I used to live. I used to live through that doorway. And I used to live back there, and Grandma Rose and Grandpa Louie also lived back there. And as a little kid in the morning, I used to go into Grandma's bedroom and help her lace up her corsets after she took her teeth out of the glass. Behind me is the room that I lived in. Straight ahead, and right here to the left, was where Grandma and Grandpa Adler lived. This is my room on the corner from the outside. We saw it before from the inside. And I remember distinctly my cousin Richard Adler, who was upset with something. I was looking out this window, and he was out here, literally, this is no baloney, punching the wall until his knuckles bled. I was only a little kid, but it was a spectacle. Actually, I was going to come here once with a pickup truck and some strong young guys and take this rock home. This was a rock that, as a little kid to me, was the biggest rock on the, like the Rock of Gibraltar. It was that big. And when I brought my grandkids here to show them the old hotel and talk about this monstrous rock, we discovered that the rock really wasn't that big. But it's still here, and I'm still trying to think of ways to come and get it. This used to be a road that went all the way around the hotel. Now it's pretty much a walking path, but to the right of where we're standing was a tennis court. Believe it or not, a very well-maintained tennis court. One court, right here.
Now we'll take a look at what the hotel looks like today. Unfortunately, it's seen better days. There's been a lot of break-ins and a lot of vandalism in the hotel. And you'll see they tried to board up everything they possibly could, and every time you board something up, people come along and tear the boards off and go in anyway. There's been a lot of unique people coming into the hotel, a lot of graffiti. One time when I was in there, there was a table set up for some devil worshiping, and there were skulls on the table with candles, and very bizarre. This is one of the hallways. This was all covered with beautiful tin ceilings, and people broke in and stole all of the tin. It was a beautiful molded tin, and they stole all of the tin off the ceilings. You can see how the outside elements are now coming inside. There's moss growing on the carpet, and the ceilings are falling in because the roofs are bad. There again, you can see some of the moss growing. Just very unfortunate that it's come to, it's fallen into such despair. And this is one of the guest rooms. And it'll be funny because you'll walk along and you'll see rooms that were just like the ones we looked at, and then you'll come across a room like this. And here was a dress laid out on a chair and left by a guest, apparently. You'll also notice we go through a lot of the bizarre wallpaper. Of course, that was a style back in the day. There was a lot of foil wallpaper that we'll see as we go along. We're going to look, this is some of the kitchen. You can see what it looks like now. Again, there were two kosher kitchens, and they had the meat dishes were blue and the dairy dishes were white, and they had a kitchen for each, the meat, and then also a side for the dairy. When I went in there originally, straight ahead, you'll see a cabinet that was full of dishes. And recently somebody has broke in and knocked that over, and all the dishes are on the floor now. And because it's, there's been a lot of water damage and a lot of, there's been no heat. So you'll see a lot of the paint just peeling right off the walls. Again, more graffiti. This is the dining room, and it was very unfortunate that when the people broke in, they actually tried to start a fire in this room. So they piled tables up and mattresses and lit them on fire, but they did not ignite. So the fire went out, but it's could have been pretty devastating. You can notice on the left-hand side, it's where the stage is for the dining room. And again, just the tables and chairs, everything thrown everywhere. A lot of graffiti. This is a front lobby. And notice there's just paperwork everywhere. You can see the ceiling up by the ceiling fan is all starting to fall in. More graffiti. And there's the elevator straight ahead. There's the front desk, how it looks today. This is the card room that I told you about. It's very unique now that they've done everything they can to board it up and just put whatever they had across the doors and windows to keep people out. This is the ballroom, and once was very beautiful. And right now, I was just there the other day when I took Mike through, and you'll notice the water there. Well, it was actually a whole lake when we were there the other day. It's just pouring down through the roof. And the roof above the ballroom is completely rotted, and it's just pouring down through the roof. There's been a number of break-ins just recently, too. There were people that broke in, and fortunately, they were arrested this time. And this is this was a beautiful staircase. It had an Art Deco lamp that was on the top of the stair, a new post, but that's been stolen long ago. You can see, I think there's a light fixture at the top of the new post there. And that's where there was another Art Deco lamp. Some of the rooms with the double beds, more graffiti. And yeah, a lot of stuff was just left behind. People broke in, and we found that they were living there. There was a lot of either clothing, but people were sleeping on the mattresses and spending the night here. I'm sure it's kids that are going in and doing it. These are some of the guest rooms, and you can. And a lot of these had their own bathrooms. Now, I own the Roseboro Hotel, and there's 135 rooms and only 23 bathrooms, and everyone shared. But this was built in 1927, and all of the rooms had their own bathrooms. So that was a nice change. Again, more rooms, more. There's nothing. Most everything has been destroyed. It either looks like this or, and unfortunately, the last time I was there, someone had kicked a lot of the walls in. But look at this graffiti, and look at the time that somebody put in to do this graffiti. It's quite amazing. You can see there's the roof. You can see right out the, you can see the daylight. So definitely rotted through. This is the result of a rotted roof. It just all falls in. Just a lot of junk. And this is why I took the switchboard, because it was, this is what it looked like. And I was afraid that it was going to really be destroyed further. So we took it out. Some ornate ceilings. This is actually in the lobby. You'll see that I held a workshop there a couple of months ago, and there was a group that came in, and it was called Buried by Time Photography. And they came in and took a lot of these shots that you'll see now. And these people came from all over New England to come in and take photographs of this hotel. You'll notice the foil wallpaper. There's another one of the bedrooms with, notice the ceiling is all rotted away, and all the tin is gone. This was the beauty shop downstairs. Another one of the rooms. One time they had an exercise area. And there's a picture of what it looks like today. Just unfortunate. It's such a beautiful hotel. That's that bridge that Mike was talking about. He used to be able to walk from the archway all the way over, and you could kind of see some windows all the way over. It was where the pavilion cottages were located on the other side. And the bridge used to connect this hotel to the pavilion cottages next door. This is what we call the money shot. Notice the foil wallpaper, kind of very dated wallpaper, and all of the phones and the TVs. Unfortunately, one of the break-ins recently, somebody broke in and took all of these television sets and threw them out the window. They broke all the glass, and these are several stories up, so they just threw them all out the window. And even though you have no trespassing signs, people just go in anyway. They just totally ignore it. There's a swimming pool. This was the second pool. The first pool, the original pool, was replaced by the time when the Yarconis came. This is actually much larger than it looks, but they put this new pool in. So the pool itself is not bad, in bad shape, but it's just unfortunate that the hotel looks so bad. This is the spa area, and each of these rooms you could go in and have a spa treatment. This is something interesting that many people didn't know, but the former mayor of New York City, Ed Koch, worked at the Adler Hotel. He was he spent a summer as a bus captain at the Adler Hotel. Not sure how much he worked, because he said that he waited on. Did a little waiting on tables, played a little tennis, and then a little waiting on tables, then a little swimming. So it was interesting. And the last thing that I think is that was interesting is that the Adler Hotel can still be found on TripAdvisor. And the review says, okay, so my review of the Adler Hotel and the spa is a little misleading. I definitely would rate it a 5-star resort, but only if you're an avid urban explorer or photographer. Unfortunately for everyone else, the Adler is no longer in business, although there have been talks of rehabilitating the hotel and reopening it. Until then, there's no vacation to be had for conventional travelers here. So that gives you kind of a brief overview of what it was like in its heyday and what it's like today. What I'm going to do is, I don't usually do this, but we have a small group tonight. And so if you have questions or comments, you can actually go up and unmute yourself and ask the questions. I did get a couple of questions, and one of them was about, is anyone working to clean up the hotel and restore it as a historic building? So what's happened with the hotel is, back in about 15 years ago, a group of Koreans came in to Sharon Springs, and they bought the Adler Hotel, the Washington Hotel, the Columbia Hotel, the Imperial Baths, and a bunch of property. So they bought all of the property, and nothing happened for many, many, many years. And there was a lot of internal turmoil within that group. There was some embezzlement and some other things like that. And then one man, one of the Korean men, his name is Kimson Cho, bought everybody else out. And then he started to work on the Imperial Baths to remodel them. And, you know, he was planning to do about a $15 million renovation on the baths, and he secured funding, and he also got a number of grants. The issue was he didn't really follow what he said he was going to do. And he had gotten, you know, the permission from he'd got his building permits, and you have to go before the planning board, and there's some governing bodies that are over that project. He didn't do what he said he was going to do. And so the bank pulled the funding on him. And also, the other thing is he had a pilot, which is payment in lieu of taxes. And the way that works is you get a lower tax during the time that you're doing construction, you apply for that. And then you get, after you're in business, the taxes go back up because you will be bringing in money. Well, the village said, we're not going to renew the pilot unless you fix the violations, because on the Adler Hotel, because it's in really, really, really bad shape. So he ended up doing something a little bit sneaky. He ended up selling the hotel. He gave a woman here in town $10,000 and told her to pay him the $10,000. And for that, she could buy the hotel. And so she did it. And the hotel's in her name. And then what happened there is then he came back and he said, well, I only did that temporarily because I had to get the hotel out of my name. So I could get my taxes, the pilot again. And now she said she's not going to give him the hotel back. She's trying to sell it herself. And she says, I'll sell it for $75,000. And whatever I make on it, it's just money that I didn't have, because she didn't have to pay the $10,000 to begin with. It was his money. So she owns it now. She's got it up for sale and trying to sell it for whatever she can. Unfortunately, she's scrapping it out right now and taking anything of value and scrapping it. And she's also trying to lumber or log the land. There's about 18 acres to go with it. Somebody asked a question about reparations and what was reparation. Well, after World War II, the Germans sent many of the Holocaust survivors to the United States for treatment, because of the horrible way that they were treated in concentration camps. So they sent them over to New York, and many of the spa towns said that they would not take the Jewish people. And as you may know, that for a period of time, there was a moratorium on many of the hotels would not take Jewish people at all. Hotels like Saratoga Springs, there were actually notices saying we will not take any Jewish people. Well, Sharon Springs said we'll take them, because they got paid reparation for every treatment that they got. And depending on how severe your injuries or your treatment was, depended on how much reparation was paid to you. And the Jewish people really liked the spa treatments, so they came to Sharon Springs to get their treatments. And that's why Spielberg was doing his movie Schindler's List, he came here to interview the Holocaust survivors, because many of the people were here. They had their tattooed arms, and they came actually for the treatments. And so he came here to interview those survivors. And that was a lot of what he based his movie on. Let's see. Oh, somebody's asking me to turn my video on. I think I have to exit. Hang on a minute. There we go. Sorry about that. Let me see some more of the questions. Also, how were the spa rooms connected to the springs? Well, the springs came through down through the village, and there's something called Brimstone Creek, which is just across the way. A lot of these, the spas and the temples, like the Magnesia Temple, the water came right to the temples, and it came from underground, and it was just piped there. So they would find where the spring came through. The springs are still there, but they have them capped off. Somebody was asking me about the video. This whole thing will be, anybody who's on this will get a link to the presentation, and you'll be able to watch it later. And there was some glitch where I think people were not able to see the whole thing. So you will get a link to it and be able to watch it afterwards. Let me see. Is there any talk of state turning the spa into a state park to save the spas? I don't know. I've not heard of anything along that line. So what is the status of the Imperial Baths now that they ran out of money? Well, they're just sitting there. There's a stop work order on it. The village put a stop work order on them because they have not followed suit with what they said they were going to do. And they started doing things like they changed the flow of the creek. And they have done some things that they spent like almost $1 million on the back of the spa, and they built a big pond and they stopped the flow of the creek. So I think there's been a lot of concerns about that. Let's see. Did the opening of the thruway have an effect on the Adler as traffic? Well, there was a bus stop that was just right down at the bottom of the hill of the of Adler Drive, and the guests that would come would either come by bus. Most of them came by bus, or they would drive their own cars. And but most of them came to the transportation center, so they had a very short walk to get up to the Adler Hotel. How any idea how much room a room would cost in the 1930s? I do. It was pretty cheap, but by today's standards. But some of them were sold in packages to where they would come and they would sell like the rooms, and then they would also sell it with a package that might include meals. I have, unfortunately, because the program is, I try to keep them about an hour. I have so many more interviews that are so interesting. And Maureen Lotus talks about the dining room and how elaborate the meals were. And they would come in and the room beside the dining room was a bar, and they didn't really have a liquor license when they first started. I actually have a copy of their liquor license. And but when they first started, they didn't have a liquor license. So they just had a room next door where they included the liquor in with their meals. And so they would have, you know, little shot glasses, and you could get rye, or they would have a big pot where they would put manischewitz, and they would dip out of that. And so they were packaged deals with but they're very elaborate meals. It was funny, she said they could never say the word breast. So on the menu, it would say chicken tops and bottoms. You couldn't say thigh or breast, so it had to be, or white meat or dark meat, so it had to be chicken tops or bottoms, which I thought was interesting. Any other questions anybody has?
Yeah, I had a question. I noticed that it was built, it started in 27 and they finished 28, and that was right in the middle of the Depression. So that didn't affect their ability to either get financing or continue with the construction?
Well, keep in mind, he was already, by that time, he had owned, he owned the Victor Hotel, or Hotel Victor. And I'm sure that he used some of that for collateral. And then he really started to get in serious about the hotel business, and then went on to buy the other hotels. And so he must have done very, very well in the hotel business. He was actually a tailor when he started, and he had no hotel experience. And it wasn't until he came up here to Sharon Springs and thought that this is really an interesting opportunity. And when you see 10,000 people coming in the summers, they all needed a place to stay. And at one time, like I said, there were over 60 hotels and boarding houses here, and so many of them burned down. I think we're coming out with a new book on the history, or the many fires of Sharon Springs. And in that book, I think there's, gosh, there's probably 60 fires. Not every hotel burned down, but a lot of there were many houses and businesses that burned. Actually, one night we lost 20, in 1926, we lost 13 buildings in November of that year, caught on fire, and the whole block burned. So,
yeah, I think my great grandfather's hotel burned in 56. And if you go to newspapers.com, you can find articles about the fire.
Yeah. Yeah, it's there was so much more I'd love to have shared, but like I said, it's hard to keep it to an hour. Mike had so many, Mike Kochkis, the, you know, the grandson, it was wonderful to spend time with him and going through there. But yeah, his reaction was just, he was just horrified to see what had happened and what it looks like today, because it's really changed. I mean, it's pretty sad. There is a question about how was the hotel heated. It was not heated. It was strictly a summer residence. All these hotels, none of them have insulation. All of the pipe, the plumbing was on the outside of the building, so it made it easy for them to drain the water in the winter, and so they drained the water, and but they were not heated, and the insulation is horrible. I know myself, having this big monstrosity that I have, it's there's no insulation, and so I can only afford to heat a few of the rooms. I actually live in the hotel, and I heat the area that I live in, and then I do heat the ballroom, the dining room, and not the ballroom, the lobby, the dining room, the kitchen of the hotel, because I do use those year round. But I can't heat the ballroom, because it's just unbelievable. It cost me $16,000 just to do this portion of that I'm heating. So nothing else you could, you really can't heat these big buildings. Any other questions?
Yeah, in the video, he talked about Myers working at the elevator or something. And I remember my parents telling me that there's still a mansion, the Myers mansion, and I guess they owned a glove place in Gloversville or something.
That's correct. The Myers corn family estate up there, there were five homes in that compound. And just last week, those went up on auction and went incredibly cheap. The mansion itself sold for $55,000. And it needs some work, but it's just amazing inside. And but there were only four people at the auction. Two of them were the Corn family relatives, and they bought the property across the way where the orchard and the swimming pool is. And a neighbor bought the cottage that was there, and then a man from out of town bought the actual mansion. But nobody knew about the auction, and that's why it sold so cheap.
So is he going to live there, the person who bought the mansion?
He's not going to live there. He's going to make it into a seasonal residence where he can just come and spend summers here. So, but you're probably going to have to, the estimation to fix it was somewhere north of 500,000. But it's going to be gorgeous when it's done. So, yeah, so that's it. I appreciate everybody joining. I am going to be putting a video together of this when it's after tonight, and you'll all get a link. So I know some people joined late, and if you want to watch the video at a later date, you'll be able to. All of our videos are on our YouTube channel. So once we finish them, they go on. And next year, we have three more programs the rest of the year. We have one coming up with Pete Lindemann, and that program's called They May Just Have Found James Tenner's Legs, which is the name of a book he's just written. And it's a compilation of all very interesting stories that he's written. And he's a historian here in Schoharie County. And then November is the assassination of John F. Kennedy. I think it's 68 years later. And that's going to be a very interesting program. And then the last one is the history of Santa Claus for December. Next year, we're doubling the program. So we're going to actually have 24 programs a year. So because we had people even on the program tonight that were from Singapore and India. And so we're getting quite a large following, and people are following it from all over the world. So it's been great to have these. So there's other programs about hotels. One of the programs somebody's asking me about, will we be doing more programs on the hotels in the village? And the answer is yes, we will. I've got one on that we do on the Roseboro Hotel. We'll be looking at some of the other hotels that were here. And those will be part of the program next year. So,
when is this book that you mentioned coming out, Ron, about the fires?
It is. We just finished editing it. I believe as soon as the beginning of November. And we'll, if you follow us or you're part of this program, you will get an email about it. And it's a great book. Sandy Manco is one of our historians, and she's on the board of directors at the Historical Society, and she has written a number of the historical books here, and that one should be, we're just ready to start printing, so it should be shortly. Any other questions? Well, thank you all for coming tonight, and we will be sending you a link, and appreciate you following us and learning more about Sharon Springs. And as I said, our programs next year are going to be a little bit more global in nature. So we're trying to do some local and some of major, or, you know, of larger interest, like we're doing a program on Ruth Bader Ginsburg. There's one on Amish life in Sharon in Schoharie County. There's really a variety that's coming up. So we're doing a program on hops farming, just a great a variety of presentations next year. So thank you all, and we'll look forward to seeing you at our next presentation.